Good morning. It's good to be here in the house of worship this morning with everyone as we filter in and get settled. Just praise God for another beautiful week and the privilege of being together today. Glad for all of you who are with us. Lloyd and Martha, we're glad you're back. The neighborhood is still in one piece, hopefully. Good to see everyone. Anybody have anyone else they'd like to introduce or welcome today? Are there any announcements that need to be made? Now, we had Quaker Bakers and House of Compassion the last couple of days. I think both of those went well. Kevin, you want to report on that?
Yes, Quaker Bakers. We had 37 deliveries yesterday. We had, for lack of better words, tried to somewhat minimize that number by doing double plates for families, and I think we had about 9 or 10 families that we did yesterday in the community. So if we had broken those out, we would have had a lot more, and then we had all kinds of breads, and I think Connie made cherry pies, I think like 12 of them. 13 technically, but 12 of them. One of them fell off into my basket. So that count as, you know, one of my deliveries, I guess, for lack of better words. So we could have had many, many folks that we attended to, but we ended up doing 37. We had quite a few folks who did some volunteering, either through donation or packing, etc. So thank you guys for doing that.
Thank you, Kevin.
Jane, you may have to put that mic down.
Is that better? Thanks, Evelyn.
Adam Kester has one.
Adam.
Now I'll talk really low so she doesn't have to lift it back up. Okay, the dates for Christian Ed, again, I'm going to run through them quick, and I'm going to add one more. August 28th, we have a safety training. So if you want to be a Sunday school teacher and you need to go through the training video and course for becoming a Sunday school teacher or a nursery worker, that's on August 28th at 9 a.m. We are also going to double that with the new nursery during the service. So if you're going to be a volunteer who wants to serve during the service for nursery after the children's message, that's going to happen on that day as well. So August 28th, 9 to 10 before the church service, okay? September 4th is going to be an elective Sunday school teacher training, a time for us to be able to pour back into all the teachers or somebody who's been a teacher or you want to be a teacher, you want to build confidence in being a teacher, come on out to that. We'll be here at 9 a.m. I haven't figured out exactly the location yet, but we'll be in the building. Sunday school starts September 11th at 9 a.m. here, and then the same day we're going to start another class in the evenings on Sunday, 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. starting September 11th. We're going to be diving deep into a college level class on how to study the Bible and how to have confidence in the Bible when you're studying it. So if you've ever read the passage, a paragraph, a chapter in the Bible, and you go, I think I know what it's saying, or I think I know what the main point is, but I'm not really confident, this class is hopefully going to, within the semester, teach you to be confident in your analysis and understanding of the Word of God. So that's the goal we'll be doing. It's partly a video series, and then we'll have discussion and discussion for anyone who has any questions or want to talk more or go through some of the lessons to make sure that everyone's on the same page. We're going to be going through a book. The cost of that's going to be $45. It's basically going to cover the cost of the book and the workbook, and then a little couple bucks in there so we can have a snack each week, have something to eat. It's going to be from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. every Sunday from September 11th until December 4th. And we're skipping Thanksgiving, I believe. So that week, one of the days is skipped in Thanksgiving. So that's going to be happening. We're going to be going over the book called Grasping God's Word. So I think that's everything. If you have any questions, please ask me about any of those, and I'll help you make sure you know the dates. Thanks.
Thank you, Adam. The other thing we're going to start is on Wednesday evenings, the same week that Sunday school starts, from probably like 6:30 to 7:15, we're just going to come and read Scripture. We're just going to read Scripture and sit with the Scripture. Lectio Divina, divine reading. We're just going to read Scripture, be still in front of it, and then maybe have a little conversation about what we've heard from the Spirit of God about the reading of that particular passage. So that'll also begin in September, that second week. Lectio Divina in the reading of simple Scripture, and there's not going to be any kind of study. It's just going to be the reading of God's Word. Okay? Thank you.
We had a prayer request earlier this week for Megan Engledew. She was back in the hospital for a procedure that was scheduled. However, she was running a high temp the day that she went back. So they kept her, and Dottie sent me an update this morning. Her fever is gone. Her bilirubin is down. That's good. Doctors don't know what caused the fever for sure. They will continue the antibiotics, but discontinue one of her immunosuppressants. And that's something she takes for the rest of her life because of her transplant. She might come home today. So I think we can celebrate progress.
In that same vein, I just spoke with Caitlin Toole. Her father, Steve Hall, went in for kind of an emergency surgery yesterday. They were supposed to start at 7 a.m. They didn't start till 3 p.m. So that he didn't get out of surgery until 10 p.m. last night. It was 7 hours long. And what had happened, he, over the last few months, he's been losing the ability to use his arms. And a few weeks ago, he couldn't even raise his arms. So what they discovered was he did not have ALS. That's what they were afraid of, is that he had Lou Gehrig's disease. But what had happened was that his C2, C3, C4 vertebrae were pushing and crushing down blood vessels and pushed so much pressure with spinal fluid on his spinal cord, it was cutting his spinal cord off. So the 7-hour procedure was to go in and clean that out, realign his spinal column, and then fuse those vertebrae together. And he's doing a lot better. I just talked to Caitlin not 5 minutes ago. That's why I was a little bit late. But so we want to praise the Lord that it was not Lou Gehrig's, it wasn't ALS, and that it'll be a long process, but it's better than some other diseases he could have had. So Caitlin wanted to share that with you, and I want to share something that happened is that right before Steve went into surgery, there was no pastor there, so Caitlin prayed for Steve and Kelly, and that's a huge thing. She became the spiritual leader right then in that moment, and she offered the prayer. And I want to praise the Lord for that. I mean, that's almost as miraculous as this, you know, that people are finding their confidence in the Spirit and trusting God. So I want to praise the Lord on all accounts, and also for Megan. Well,
the last few months when I've talked about House of Compassion, we've had around the low 30s for turnout. So I decided not to make quite as much food this time. We had 58. It seemed like a whole lot more than 58 because they came back for seconds and some thirds. We start serving at 5:15, or 5 till 6:15. At 5:15, Krista said to me, "Val, do we have more meat?" And I said, "No." We served a Reuben casserole, which I've never made before. It was very well received, and we also, as an option for people like me who do not like sauerkraut, had loose meat sandwiches. So we went to the fridge. We heated up scalloped potatoes and ham leftover. We finished that off. There was beef fajita meat, it looked like. We put that on a bun and finished all of that. There was chicken fajita meat. We finished all of that. At 6 o'clock, and the Reuben casserole was gone too, I shouldn't say that. At 6 o'clock, there's always one African-American man that comes very, very late. And I'm sure he has mental health issues because he won't sit with anybody else and he won't talk to anybody else. Basically, he will point at what he wants and say, and kind of motion more, and he will ask sometimes what's in that. But he hardly talks. And he came, and at that point we were cutting up leftover breakfast sausage and adding it to some cheesy potatoes to make a casserole, and we still had to heat it up, and he had to wait. And I think there were others that came yet after him. So we pretty much cleaned out the refrigerator. There wasn't much left in there anyway, which is all good too. I am amazed by this group of people, the people that bake for me. Every month I think, I'm not gonna have somebody new. One of these months I'm not gonna have somebody new come along. Dick Talbot came up to me last Sunday and said Jane Whitehead and I would like to come. So they were our new people, and I love sharing House of Compassion with people. The ministry there is amazing. It's amazing because of the number of volunteers that make that place happen and the number of different churches that come together to make that happen. And I think, Lord, that's what heaven will be like someday, except we'll all be singing your praises, all different groups of people. So I just want to say thank you. Thank you for being a part of that.
No, it occurs to me that there are so many ministries going on, and praise for all the volunteers that do these things, but I want to say a special thanks for those who have seen that as their vision. For instance, Quaker Bakers with Connie and Kevin, and House of Compassion with Val, and those who see a vision and go forward with it and organize the rest of us to come along. So I just praise God for your work in that too. Are there any other announcements this morning before we go to our call to worship?
Okay. There's a time to laugh and there's a time to cry. And sorrow is also upon my family. I got word Thursday morning my brother died. Mm. 65 years old, looking forward to retirement, perfect health. For years and years, he's always been in the gym, working out, riding his bike, always in good health. But Thursday morning, we had a set of storms go through. He lives in Mason City, and some limbs had come down on the house, some power lines were down. He had gone out to see about the situation, and the neighbor had looked out the window and saw him laying there, and he was dead. Mm. It's just a shock to all of us. Mm. They did an autopsy, and guess what? It had nothing to do with electrocution. They don't know what happened. Mm. He had a lot of trauma to the body, so they're suspecting a hit and run. So his body's been sent down to Des Moines or Iowa City, I don't know, for more criminal investigation. He was wearing one of his bicycle shirts, which are bright in color, and they found tire tracks on it. So at this point, we're going to go forward with a wake and funeral service up in Mason City. He had three sons. The two oldest sons, he was so proud of. I mean, they did well in high school. They graduated out of Iowa State. They got big jobs. They're doing well. But he had a third son. And the third son is like a prodigal son. He got so caught up in this world with drugs and alcohol. He's been spending the last year in prison, and he was just allowed to come back to Denny's, my brother's, on a probation basis. Denny was going to try and help him, and now he's dead. So we don't know what's going to happen to Adam. But anyway,
I wanted to share it with you guys because you're my family here. And there's going to be a lot of strength that needs to be put forth for this whole situation.
I have one announcement. I just want to thank the people that I have on Facebook, seeing I had surgeries and some medical problems. Thank you for the prayers. I'm still recovering from my gallbladder removal. They had to make a bigger incision. I guess the gallbladder has been bad for quite some time. It's been going on for a few years. Here in about 3 months, I got an ultrasound on my pancreas again. So hopefully nothing's going on with that. They're hoping that everything goes down on that. So thank you, everyone.
Let's move into worship with our call to worship, and then we'll have prayer. Call to worship is from Psalm 82. God presides in the great assembly. He gives judgment among the gods. How long will you defend the unjust and show partiality to the wicked? Defend the cause of the weak and the fatherless. Maintain the rights of the poor and oppressed. Rescue the weak and needy. Deliver them from the hand of the wicked. They know nothing. They understand nothing. They walk about in darkness. All the foundations of the earth are shaken. I said, "You are gods. You are all sons of the Most High. But you will die like mere men. You will fall like every other ruler. Rise up, O God, judge the earth, for all the nations are your inheritance." Please join me in prayer. Father, we are blessed to be here together this morning in your presence. It's been a busy week, and we have busy lives. But let us lay aside that busyness and those preoccupations. If even for the next hour, Father, let us lay them aside and sit at your feet and hear your voice and feel your arms gently around us. Father, there are so many needs and hurts. We pray, we lift them to you now. We pray for Megan right at this moment, that you would strengthen her, give doctors wisdom, give a peace to that family that is beyond understanding. We pray that that comfort will come to Rochelle as well as she is in the loss of her brother. May that family be surrounded by you and by your loving care. And for Caitlin's father and their family, we just pray, Father, for all of these hurts around us. Pray that we will be your instruments of peace and care as we try to minister to others. Father, I pray now that as we give our tithes and offerings, that you would bless each gift and bless each giver, that your kingdom will go forward on earth. In Jesus' name, amen.
God, to whom all blessings flow, the doxology. We're going to sing it with an organist. It's going to be slower than we're used to. So let's rise up and sing the doxology together.
Praise Him, all creatures.
Thank you, Ty. And thank you, Kevin, for the music. Let's remain standing. Let's sing our opening hymn together, Hallelujah, hymn 189. And of course, because the way the planets aligned this week, we have no accompanists. They're all gone. So we're going to sing a cappella. So we're going to sing the four verses of Hallelujah. Alleluia, 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 Alleluia. Jesus, we thank you for this gathering today in our simplicity. Thank you for letting us worship you with our voices and our hearts and our lungs and our diaphragms and our lips. Bless our time together. Thank you for your presence among us. Touch those who are hurting and struggling, those going through transitions. Empower them as they move on, as they relocate, as they change places in their world. We ask you to be especially close to those going off to college this week. Grace them, and may they go with you. May they carry you in their hearts. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. If the children would come up for the children's message. Candy ready? All right. Good morning, Caden. Let's sit down here. Jordan, Grace, Matthew, Charlie, how you doing, pal? Hey, Eli, how you doing, pal? All right. Well, Grace, did you get moved? Get to your new back here to Quaker Dale? All right, good deal. Got all your toys, your bed set up, ready to go. All right, good deal. Matthew, thank you for helping yesterday. You bet. You know, there's some things in Scripture that talk about that when we pray and when we praise God, it's like a good smell to God's nose, God's nostrils. We have to talk about God like a person because that's the only way we can think about God, because God is so wonderful and great. But in the book of Revelation and in the book of Hebrews, there's places where it talks about that when we pray, it's like aroma, a good smell coming to God. God, in other words, God enjoys it when we pray to Him, when we listen to Him, when we praise Him. Is there anything you praise God for this week? Anything you thank God for this week? Matthew? That Grace and Patty and Adam got moved in. You praise the Lord for that, Caden. That He's with us every day. Did you praise God for anything this week? Maybe a good lunch that Mom fixed. Did you praise the Lord? Did you thank God, Charlie? That Jesus loves you wherever you are. Okay. Well, when we Matthew.
When my dad and I got our focus running.
When what?
My dad and I got our new gray Ford Focus running.
Oh, you got the gray Focus running? All right. You praise God for that? All right. Well, when we praise God and when we pray to God, it smells good. Can you smell it? There.
Smell.
I know, I need to be over here. Here's the problem. How can you smell it? Mm-hmm. Isn't that pleasing? Inside of it, it kind of makes you smile, doesn't it? Oh, that smells good. That's the same thing that happens in the heart of God. Every time we talk to God, every time we praise the Lord, God is pleased. I want you to remember that. Every time that we pray and praise God, that makes the heart of God smile. That's pretty cool. That's pretty neat if you think about that. And sometimes we praise God in the middle of night. Sometimes when we're eating our meals. Who are you waving to, Grace? Who are you waving to, honey? Dad? All right. So I want you to remember how we can make God's heart smile. When we praise Him and thank Him for our family, we thank Him for the food, we thank Him for water, electricity, thank Him for His love, thank Him for all His goodness, His forgiveness, all the things that God pours out to us. When we praise the Lord, that makes God's heart smile. Okay? Can you remember that? Can anybody tell me last Sunday's sermon, what it was about? That's okay. Who was here last Sunday? Were you here, Grace? Remember the bowl? What was in the bowl? Pepper. Yep, that's right. And whenever we have a good thought, when we have a thought of Jesus, it pushes the bad thoughts out of the way. Right? Okay. Good. Now, who would you like to pray for? Is there anybody you'd like to pray for today, Grace? Your dad? Okay. Charlie? Your grandma? Anyone else? Your dad's here, isn't he? We want to thank... Does that make you happy? You praise the Lord at your dad's home? Yeah. All right. Well, let's take hands and let's pray. Here. It's okay. Caden, where are your teeth going, buddy? You're losing teeth. No, they're there. I see them now. All right. Sweet Jesus, thank you for these children. Thank you for Eli. Thank you for his good spirit and the way he loves to talk and ride his bike. Bless him. Thank you that Dad's home for a few days. And Lord, thank you for Charlie. Thank you for giving him his musical talents and his love for music. And bless Charlie. And Lord, thank you for Matthew and his practical help yesterday as he helped the Kesters move. Thank you that Matthew's in likes to tinker with stuff and take things apart and figure out how things work. And Lord, thank you for Grace and her bubbly spirit. Thank you that she got moved. And Lord, thank you for Jordan. Thank you that she's a great big sister to Harper, and that she's full of sweetness and love. And Lord, thank you for Caden. Thank you for his good mind and his good heart. And Lord, just continue to work in our children, and may you bless them in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. Jordan, would you go first? Well, Grace is going to go first. Okay, that's all right. See you, Grace. Caden, Charlie, Matthew, Eli. Let's take our hymn books once again and turn to hymn 315, Were You There? Or you can follow with the lyrics on the screen. I tried to pick songs that might be a little easier for us to sing a cappella. This is a song that I learned at Camp Quaker Haven in Arkansas City, Kansas, when I was a freshman in high school at the camp. Were you there? Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Sometimes it causes me to tremble. Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Ladies, would you sing the second verse? Chapter of Luke, Luke 49 through 59.
These are the words of Jesus. I have come to bring fire on the earth, and how I wish it were already kindled. But I have a baptism to undergo, and how distressed I am until it is completed. Do you think I came to bring peace on earth? No, I tell you, but division. From now on, there will be five in one family divided against each other, three against two and two against three. They will be divided, father against son and son against father, mother against daughter, daughter against mother, mother-in-law against daughter-in-law, and daughter-in-law against mother-in-law. He said to a crowd, when you see a cloud rising in the west, immediately you say, it's going to rain, and it does. And when the south wind blows, you say, it's going to be hot, and it is. Hypocrites, you know how to interpret the appearance of the earth and the sky. How is it that you don't know how to interpret this present time? Why don't you judge for yourselves what is right? As you are going with your adversary to the magistrate, try hard to be reconciled to him on the way, or he may drag you off to the judge, and the judge turn you over to the officer, and the officer throw you into prison. I tell you, you will not get out until you have paid the last penny.
This is a text that's a kind of a difficult one for us to read, because we think about Jesus as the Prince of Peace and the angels who sang, glory to God in the highest and peace on whom God's favor rests. And yet here Jesus says, I've not come to bring peace but division, that families will be split up, that there'll be animosity between people. But a careful study of Jesus' words, and especially in the first century context of his life, is that these words about division are about that Jesus is reordering a way of looking at God and the world. He's offering another worldview, and it's challenging the four main symbols of Judaism, the Torah, the presence of God in the Word. There's an ancient rabbinical saying that where two or three are gathered, the Torah is in their midst. Jesus says, where two or three are gathered, I'm in your midst. A reestablishing of the Torah. He said, you have heard it said, but I say unto you, a reinterpretation of the ancient law, the Torah. And so Jesus is redefining the Torah, the law of God. Not only is he redefining that, he's also redefining the temple, the presence of God on earth where God dwelt. Tear down this temple and 3 days I'll rebuild it. And in fact, in the second chapter of John, he uses two different words, one for temple, but then he says, this shrine, I will rebuild this shrine, the Holy of Holies. The third is the land that was promised to Abraham and to the people of Israel. It gave birth to this people. Jesus reinterprets it. Go into all the world making disciples. It's just not about Palestine and the Holy Land. Jesus is saying that God is redeeming and reclaiming the whole earth. And also, the fourth symbol was racism and ethnicity. The Jews were the people of the book, the people of God. And now Jesus is saying, look, whoever does the will of the Father is my mother and my brother and my sisters. Jesus comes in the middle of this mess in the first century and calls for a new way of looking at the God of Israel, the creator of the world and the deliverer of humanity. He reorders it around himself. You have heard it said, but I say to you, destroy this temple and I'll rebuild it in 3 days. Go into all the world making disciples. Who are my mother and my brothers? And he looked around the circle around him and said, here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does God's will is my brother and sister and mother. This God is acting so concretely in Jesus of Nazareth that Jesus creates a crisis. Peace in the sense of the status quo is now disrupted, says Fred Craddock, the New Testament scholar. That Jesus creates a crisis in our lives, a time of judgment, a time of decision. That he causes division. And we love to sing about the Prince of Peace. We remember the angels announcing Christ's birth, but we also need to remember old Simeon in the temple who prophesied over the infant Jesus, this child is destined to cause the rising and falling of many in Israel, and he will be a sign that will be spoken against. Jesus Christ creates a crisis during his earthly ministry. He creates a crisis and a series of crises today in our context, in our sleepy little community of New Providence. Because Jesus poses a challenge of absolute loyalty. It seems that these words of Jesus stand what we understand to be the good news on its head. No, this Jesus isn't just the Prince of Peace. Well, I mean, he is, but he's also the Prince of Division. Once Jesus' ministry invades into Jewish families, they will split over him. This warning of families being divided hails from Micah 7:6, which is a prophetic passage warning of imminent crisis, urging that the only way forward is for to completely trust in God. And Jesus quotes Micah 7:6 here. The coming of Jesus creates division and a crisis. A crisis which his own fate will be the central feature. The fate of his baptism and suffering, this immersion into the sinfulness of humanity and his own people, will be culminated in the cross and resurrection. Now his people, they might have been good local weather forecasters. Oh, there's clouds coming up in the west. It's going to rain. Oh, I feel a southerly breeze. It's going to be hot today. But they do not see what's going on in the rest of the society. They don't see the oppressive regime of Herod. They don't see these wealthy and arrogant priests in Jerusalem, nor the superficial agendas of many of the Pharisees, not to mention the suffocating presence of Rome. Jesus had the insight to see that his people were heading down a dead-end road. It was only a matter of time that Jerusalem and the temple would be utterly destroyed, the Torah displaced, the Holy Land overran by the Roman legions, and the Jewish people scattered to the four winds. Jesus knew the sign of the times. While his contemporaries could interpret the clouds and the southerly winds, they could accurately predict the weather. But they refused to use their abilities to see God's mightiest act in the person of Jesus standing right before them. They chose to keep the blinders on and chose rather to be meteorologists rather than being prophets. And Jesus, the billboard of God, is right in front of them, and yet they do not know how to interpret this present moment. They do not know how to interpret this present moment. I wonder if I know how to interpret this present moment. This moment we stand in history in the United States of America. When I don't know about you, but I look at our presidential election and I shake my head and go, is this the best we can do? Can we interpret the times? Can we interpret how broken and fragile and untrusting our society has become? How broken people are? We've heard just a glimmer of it this morning. The sorrow, the heartache, the disappointment, the addictions, the brokenness. He creates a crisis that we either follow him or we don't follow him. He challenged his fellow Jews to be God's people his way, to turn the other cheek, to go the extra mile, to bless and pray for our enemies, to feed the hungry, heal the sick, visit the lonely. He called people to orbit himself rather than the Torah. He called people to find forgiveness and mercy in himself rather than in the corrupt temple. He expanded the Holy Land beyond dusty Palestine to now extend into all the world. And Jesus called all people into a new community that whoever does the will of the Father is his mother, his brothers, and his sisters. So what does this have to do with us? First, it has to come at us as a point of decision, a crisis in our own lives. Am I going to follow Jesus? Have I ever really given my life to Jesus? I had a pastor friend in Indiana who pastored this little friend's church, and an 87-year-old Quaker man gave his life to Jesus about 2 days before he died. He had been raised and nurtured in the church for 87 years and had never come to that point of decision about following Christ and saying, "You be Lord of my life, be my Savior, be my Redeemer, be my guide." We have to make a decision sooner or later. That's the first crisis. The first decision we have to make is to say, "Jesus, I'm a mess. Come and love on me and heal me and help me." Because there's lots of other things that are calling out for us to follow. Madison Avenue, Hollywood, money, image, family. All these things are calling for us to follow. And through all those voices that are calling for us, there's another voice. Come follow me. This decision, this crisis that Jesus creates, is the choice of taking one road or the other. The second thing is that this text reminds me, at least, is that we can be religious and have blinders on. These people who Jesus is speaking to are the spiritual and religious leaders of the day. And one of the things that I think we really need to take our blinders off for is our own deep sinfulness. That almost everything we do is tainted with ego and selfishness. That we cannot move towards God. God can only move towards us. That we are broken people. And even the good things that we do, they're like oily rags before our holy God. The second thing is that Jesus asks us to take the blinders off about what's really going on around us in our little town of New Providence and in the rural areas and in Eldora and in Hardin County and in Iowa and in the United States and the world. Because when we stand up for God's truth and God's justice, a division occurs. When we see things happening in our midst and we say, in the name of Jesus, this is not right. The health care system is not right in America. It is unjust. when those who can't afford health insurance have to pay more because there's no insurance company lobbying and putting pressure on the hospitals and doctors. It's backwards. It is wrong. When there's needless surgeries done by doctors, it is wrong. When we see people being oppressed and pushed down, we should say, this is not right. And that creates a division. It divides people. Do we say these things to create division? Absolutely not. We say these things and act in these ways because it's the right thing to do before Christ. But that divides people. This is Jonathan's last Sunday here among us for a while, and I'm going to use an illustration from his life that I'm very proud of. He was having a this is a $20 illustration, Jonathan. Jonathan stood up for a person in his school system that was being harassed and picked on and called names. And some of his friends didn't like that he stood up for that. It causes a division by doing what is right and loving and just. And we can look at Jesus' life and we can see that Jesus never ever adhered for us to use violence to tear down structures or injustice. But he did not retreat from injustice. And one of the things that has struck me at the multiplication conference, I was just sitting there thinking, because I heard someone use the word judgment, and I realized that the word judgment and justice go together, and that Jesus didn't retreat from the gospel of peace. He just realized that the cost of peace is justice. And God's people are called to be a just people. That in the ways that we're led to take on systems of injustice and oppression or loneliness down the street, feeding the hungry in Marshalltown, whatever it might look like, that's what we're called to be and do. And he warned us that if we did those kinds of things, we will face opposition just as he did. And so Jesus is challenging us that we pay more attention than just to the weather. He insisted that we take our blinders off to see how things are really going and how things are not going as God intended. And I think that's the place for us to start, is where the will of God is not being done. When there's no housing over someone's head, when there's no food, when there's no clothing. And right now across America, at this very hour that we're sitting here, there are thousands of American preachers who are proclaiming peace, peace. Peace and prosperity for all you believers. And we hear the convicting words of the prophet Jeremiah. They preach peace, peace, where there is no peace. And they dress the wounds of my people like they were not serious. And we have some very serious problems in our country. I'm not suggesting that we're heading down the tubes or heading for doomsday. That's not my point. But my goodness, I sense in my own spirit how untrustworthy I am of other people now. I don't hardly trust anybody. And guess what? Most of the people out there don't trust anybody either. The thieving, the breaking in, the meth labs, all the stuff that's going on around us, the brokenness, the sinfulness, the desperation of people when I look in those men's eyes in Trailer 57. Pushed alongside through an education system that didn't take the time or effort to educate them, many with mental illness problems, broken, And whatever our background is, whatever our place in life is, Jesus challenges every one of us to take those blinders off and to see the poverty and the injustice and the suffering that's prevalent around us. And make no mistake about it, we are surrounded by broken, hurting people. Surrounded. This morning, we sense that brokenness. Megan, Rochelle's family. And the first step towards us doing something is that we take a long, hard look. And we start taking the blinders off of us, and we start becoming uncomfortable. I had a conversation with a member of our church this week, and this is where this person is in their spiritual journey with Jesus. They're getting ready to take the blinders off, and it's kind of overwhelming. I didn't realize this is all going on around. Oh, yes. And when we take a long, hard look at what's going on, we begin to take the first steps in partnering with God to redeem the world. At least to redeem the world in our little corner of the world. That's all we're asked to do. We don't have to save the world. Jesus has already done that. But we are called to be symbols of that redemption right here in Little New Providence in Hardin County. Just down the street, just down the block. Around the corner. This Jesus that I've been trying to follow for almost 40 years, and you also, every time I start thinking I've got things figured out, I start getting comfortable. Here he comes, disrupting my peace, challenging the way I'm living and how I'm looking at people, and saying, son, you better take another look inside. Because I am the one who disrupts peace to bring about peace.
I didn't know if I wanted to share this or not this morning. Friday night, House of Compassion, we always pray before we start serving. And Friday night, I felt led to pray for rest, a good night's sleep for everyone there. It was hot and humid, and I thought, I don't know how many of these people can go home to air conditioning if they have fans. You know, it's sticky. Friday night felt like a good night while we were there serving. It was busy. It was fun. I was thankful. And I'm the kind of person that when I hit the pillow, I'm out. Jeff says I'll be in mid-sentence and fall asleep. And I don't know if that's true or not. I think he's exaggerating. But Friday night, I couldn't sleep. I got up, and I went to the computer, and I wrote a thank you to everybody that helped and everybody that baked. And you see, I was praising God because we had made the Reuben casserole. And I try to stick to $20 to spend, and rye bread is expensive. And I had prayed for a loaf of rye bread to make the casserole. I had gone to the grocery store Friday morning to get groceries for my family, and I almost bought a loaf of rye bread. And I thought, no, Lord, I'm going to trust you. I prayed for rye bread, and if I have to go buy rye bread when we get to Marshalltown, that's okay. And Nancy Stevens and I got there, and there was about three tables with bread on it from Hy-Vee, and there was one loaf of rye bread. And I was praising God. And then Hy-Vee came and delivered more, and we had all the buns. We had now six tables covered with bread that the people needed to sit at to eat, and we had all the buns we needed for the meat. So I was up till about 1 o'clock on the computer, and I went to bed, and at 1:45 I was still awake, and I got up again. And usually when I can't sleep, it's because God either wants me to pray or he has something to tell me. So So I finally said, okay, Lord, what are you trying to tell me? And he didn't say anything. And I finally fell asleep. Well, yesterday afternoon in the garden, picking cucumbers and tomatoes, it hit me. I was praising God for a loaf of rye bread. How silly. I was... Not that God doesn't care about the little things, and not that he doesn't want to hear us ask him for that. But I think Krista said as we ate supper at Perkins, there were two men who said Friday night's meal was the first meal they had eaten that day. There were some that came in that started eating donuts and things that Hy-Vee had left, and that always irks me a little bit, and my boys and my husband do that too. They come in and eat a cookie, and I think, can't you wait 5 more minutes? The meal's almost ready. I've worked hard at this. And I don't know how many others hadn't eaten that day. And I thought, Lord, I'm over 50 years old. I've eaten 3 meals a day plus snacks. And I am so rigid that I want to spend only $20. For a meal to feed 58 people. House of Compassion has taught me many things. It's been a spiritual journey for me. One, to be less judgmental, and I still have a long ways to go. Two, there is joy in following what God asked you to do. There is joy in being obedient. Third, he has taught me that I can trust him for anything and everything. And I've shared that before. But the lesson this week was much harder. That I am proud when I pray for a loaf of rye bread and he delivers it. And that I am too rigid. And I had to ask for his forgiveness.
Val, in the name of Jesus, you're forgiven, because Jesus tells us we have the power to forgive, and I forgive you in the name of Christ. But I also need to be forgiven, because the first time I was down there, I noticed how much they drank the milk, and the milk goes fast. And the Lord told me all week, go buy 2 extra gallons of milk and take it Friday night, and I did not do that. And in the midst of that, I was really convicted that I was thoughtless enough that I did not do that for those people. Next time that will not happen. I will not disobey again. So forgive me too. Because I think one of the things I told Chris, I said, the next time we go, we ought to have banana splits for them. We ought to do something celebratory. You know, we would pay for it. But we'd have banana splits. They deserve it. They're loved. Why not? And I think, you know, this thing about doing justice and doing what is right and lifting people up reminds me of the gentleman who made a whole bunch of money, and then he took a semi-trailer and he converted it into shower stalls. And he drives all around the country to the inner cities, and he can shower 60 homeless people an hour. They hook up to the fire hydrant, he has instant heat, and has these shower stalls. And all he does is goes and lets people who don't have access to showers to clean themselves. I thought, how stinking beautiful. How gospel is that? You know, and so I just want to praise the Lord that people are responding and acting in the name of Jesus in that way. Kevin? Let's do it, brother.
Thank you.
It led us to Golgotha. They drove nails deep in his feet and hands. Yet upon the cross I heard him say, Father, forgive them. Oh, never have I seen such love in any other eyes. Into thy hands I commit my spirit, he prayed, then he died. I stood for what seemed like years. All sense of time until I felt two tiny hands holding tight to mine. My children stood there weeping. I heard the oldest say, Father, please forgive us. And grace and beauty of Jesus be with you all. Amen.